everyone, and welcome! My name is Natalie Fetsalika.
And I'm Renee Loheed.
And we get to be your incredible duo MC for today. I am so excited, truly so excited to be here with all you beautiful women. I love getting to connect with others because it just is so, we need that. It's just so impactful. And today we have so much as a part of our program. We'll be connecting to not only one another, but we'll also be connecting to diverse cultures, heart-moving dance performances, and vulnerable testimonies, and last but not least, connecting to our greater purpose.
What a really special privilege it is to be with all of you here today, and to welcome you to our 2024 Women's Day event. And it's titled, if you haven't guessed yet, I Am Her, Inspired. I'm 100% confident, guys, that God has planned and orchestrated all of us to be here today. To really celebrate and honor women from all over and the very special women that you all are. And I hope today that as you listen in, that you'll begin to see that about yourself, but you'll also discover new truths about yourself and who you are, and really who you're meant to be. Look around, guys. This audience, by the end of our welcome, will be completely full, overflowing with women. That's so exciting and encouraging to see. And you know, you've all come as women who want to be inspired, right?
Yes.
And maybe you're searching for inspiration. Maybe you just came because somebody nudged you, your friend, your coworker, your family member, whatever brought you here today, sit back, enjoy, and just know you're not alone. We're all in this together.
Right.
You know, every year, whether I don't know if you're aware of this or not, we actually celebrate in March International Women's Day. So it's very near and dear to my heart because I have two daughters who live abroad. They live internationally. One lives in New Zealand, one lives in Australia. And we love celebrating women, especially you think about the social, the economic, the political, cultural impact of women's achievements all over the world. That's what we're here to celebrate today. Women are special. Do you know how special you are? And so we believe here, myself as a woman of faith, along with our whole women's ministry, we believe that women should be celebrated, to be recognized, to really be honored, and to very much understand that they're highly valued. I hope you feel that today. You know, that's what Jesus always intended for women to feel. Throughout the Bible, you know, we have strong faith here, and we love reading our Bibles. And the Bible shows women and their keen importance to Jesus's ministry. So today, it's the same today, and we're excited to welcome you. Very grateful that you're here, grateful that we get to be here, and grateful for our theme scripture, which is in Jeremiah 32:40. This is God's promise to us, and I want you to listen. Just let it soak in. He says, I will make you an everlasting covenant. I will never stop doing good for you, and I will inspire you. God inspires you thoroughly today.
Wow, thank you, Renee, for reminding us of that incredible scripture. I know that today is really exciting. I mean, we have such beautiful decor up. We're all dressed very nicely, but maybe for some of us, this is something that's very new, and perhaps we're feeling a little bit antsy, so I just want to encourage you, just loosen up, just shake it off. We're here, we're in this together to get inspired, to be a bright light, and just take a deep breath. Soak it all in, because you're in for a huge treat today. And I think one thing I want to encourage you with as well is to just think about what will be your takeaway from this afternoon, because truly, today will be very impactful. In just a moment, we will be embracing our diverse cultures through an international prayer and begin our Women's Day.
Hello, it's an honor to pray in Swahili. Mungu wetu wa binguni, tumekuja siku yako, tumekuja mbele zako siku ya leo, tunakushukuru sana umetupatia uhai, umetupatia afya njema na umetukusanya hapa kama watoto wako. Tunapoanza ibada hii ya wanawake, kuwa nasi, fungua mioyo yetu, tupokee neno lako na furaha. Siku inapoendelea, kuwa nasi na leo neno lako litatukuzwa. Na ni kwa haya mafupi tunaomba katika jina lako la Yesu Kristo. Amina.
It's an honor to pray in Mandarin. 亲爱的天父, 感谢您赐予我们如此珍贵的生命。 我们感谢您为我们女性创造了无限的价值和美好, 并一直给予我们无限的关爱与希望。 我们向您祷告, 您继续保护我们, 引导我们走向您的旨意。 我的天父, 是您的爱让我们充满力量, 赋予我们使命, 成为对世界的光和盐。 奉主耶稣基督的名祷告，阿门。
It is an honor to pray in Spanish. Gracias, Padre, por permitirnos estar aquí todas juntas. Gracias por darnos tu palabra, que todas juntas la vamos a estudiar y escudriñar. Te queremos y cada día nos enamoramos de ti. Gracias por bendecir a nuestras familias y nuestra salud. Hoy día vamos a celebrar tu día en honor a ti. Gracias.
The honor of praying in Russian. Дорогой Господь, я просто хочу тебя поблагодарить за все, что ты делаешь в моей жизни, Господь. Ты милосердный, ты добрый, ты велик, и ты самый любящий, Господь. Спасибо за каждую женщину, которую ты сюда привел, Господь, за то, что ты дал нам время и возможность здесь быть, чтобы хвалить твое имя. Я молюсь, чтобы ты коснулся каждого сердечка сегодня, и чтобы ты был с нами сегодня. Во имя Отца, Сына и Святого Духа. Аминь.
It's an honor to pray in English. Father in heaven, we just adore you. Thank you so much that all of this has come together, that we can spend our time getting to know each other, that we can spend our time showing you glory. It means so much to us to be able to serve you and bring honor to you. God, thank you for the scriptures that you give to us that move in our lives. Thank you as we read in Psalm 29 that you will bless us with peace. God, we just long for that. We just long for a relationship with you in this world that we live in. God, help us to just bring you great honor today as we hold each other up and learn from the scriptures. We love you so much, and we pray in your son's name. Amen.
From the dirt and the dust, you made me. From heaven you came down, and you set me free. From the slavery of my sin, the waging wars within, the deep waters I was in, God, I felt so boxed in. The debt I couldn't afford, you paid it all. And by God's grace, I adhere to your call.
Don't you love being inspired by other women? I know I do. I don't think there's anything that moves me as much as hearing from other women. And at this time in our program, we have the privilege and really the joy to hear from three remarkable women. will be courageously sharing parts of their own stories, parts of their personal lives and experiences and their testimonies. I can't wait. I got a little snippet of what they shared, and it choked me up. So first, we're going to be hearing from Naomi Collins. Woo! She'll be sharing about being inspired to heal. And Naomi actually is originally from Louisville, Kentucky. I just learned that. So I've been trying to figure out if I can detect a little Kentucky accent in there. and I understand that she loves to go to the gym. She looks pretty fit. I wish I loved to go to the gym when I was her age. She also really enjoys drawing and hiking. She's very active. And she shared that she just deeply loves her family and her friends and her three cats. So, interesting fact. After we hear from Naomi, we're going to get to hear from Carmen Ewanyonga. And how'd I do, Carmen? I've been practicing her very cool last name. She's going to be sharing about being inspired to be vulnerable. And Carmen has some deep cultural roots. I learned that she's Ghanaian. I have some friends from Ghana, so that was really neat. She was born in Italy. That's kind of a cool fact. And was actually raised in Illinois with her parents and four siblings. Four siblings. That was an active house. I also understand she just moved to Seattle to take a role as a project engineer for a renewable energy company. So she's a smart cookie, too. And then last but not least, we'll be hearing from Jenny Reitstadt. Woo! She's going to be giving us a closer look about what it means to be inspired to surrender. Jenny actually has been, she's married to her high school sweetheart. And I learned that she's been with Stephen for 20 years. Now, when you see Jenny, you'll be like, 20 years, whoa. She looks great. She also loves photography. She's a phenomenal photographer. I've definitely benefited from some of her photos over the years. She really enjoys the outdoors and, of course, loves being with her family. She has two really special boys, young men, I'll say, that she's raising with Stephen. So we're excited to hear from them. And Naomi, I'm going to call you on up, girl.
Hey, y'all. My name is Naomi. And when I was given my testimony title, my first thoughts were how my entire life felt like a series of fights. So the name felt kind of ironic. First fight I can think of was with my father. When I was a child, I remember he would set me up on top of the washing machine, take off my shoes after a long day of playing in the sun. And you know, it's heartbreaking knowing that this is the only happy memory I remember of us, you know? That a single moment when I was most likely 6 years old would be something that, would be the last time I would ever feel this warm around him. Growing up, I chased after that warmth. I always seeked validation from my dad and making his emotions my identity. When that warmth was never returned, I blamed myself for not being a good enough daughter. Maybe if I conformed to what he liked, he would spend time with me. You know, maybe if I acted more like him, he would be more involved in my own interests, not his. And every maybe was later followed by shallow breaths and streams of tears that I choked down in the back of my closet, where I felt that not even God could see me. I grew up as a child of divorce, so going through different visitations with my dad, I still tried to build the connection that I desperately prayed for. But after every visit, the love for my dad gradually turned into bitterness and hatred. The effects of my relationship with him started to pour into my relationships with my friends, my family, and my mental health. Since eighth grade, I fought against thoughts of depression and suicide. amen. I can't see because of these tears. There were days throughout the years where I felt that I couldn't pull myself out of my own head. And being in my head for so long led me to self-harm as a form of escapism. I soon based my entire identity on my mental health and the emotions that came with that. And it strained my relationships with my friends and even my own family. I soon became weary and desired to stop fighting, to stop moving, and to just end it. I continued to fight against myself, thinking if I couldn't find peace within my own mind, my own self, then it was me that was wrong. The body I was gifted had to be a mistake. In high school, I started binding my chest. I forced my voice to deepen, and I believed that God was wrong about me, that the future of my body isn't a male. I spent hours looking up surgery to change my anatomy and days researching the cost of hormone therapy. This affected who I dated. Bisexual, lesbian, asexual, queer, I used almost every single label possible to try and define who I was. This only ended in relentless depression, anger, pride, and anxiety, where I pushed everyone in my life away while also obsessively trying to hold on to them. I fought against others, only considering how they could be of use to me, moving from relationship to relationship, thinking how quickly I could fill up my roster. I think the worst fight I fought my entire life wasn't my dad or myself or other people, but God. I moved to Washington from Louisville, Kentucky, this summer coming into my junior year of high school. And you best believe I fought against the move. My senior year, I became best friends with a kind-hearted man who encouraged me to seek a relationship with God, to finally heal from the fights that I've been in. Thanks to his influence, I started studying the Bible with a few women who are here with us today, some of the most God-fearing women that I have ever met. Oh, amen. I went into these studies with the thought of it being like a so what. You know, it's not like I could completely turn from everything that had a clasp on me. Yet study after study, I found myself being more interested in what God has to say about me, how he views me, and how he wants me to live my life. I found myself wanting to heal more and more, and with the hope of being rescued from all that I put myself in. I put down the titles of what everyone else called me, and I picked up the title that God wants to adorn me with. His daughter, chosen, royalty. I am proud to say that I was baptized and truly made God's on August 27th. Praise God. I've turned 180 degrees in my life and made the decision to stop fighting, to stop running, and to start a new life. But this doesn't take away from the fact that healing is absolutely terrifying. The path to healing is a narrow one. Going against, you know, how you were raised and what you learned in life and choosing to surrender, it's not for the weak. It is for the weak, actually. Let me state that. It is for the weak. Not every day is perfect. You know, sometimes the bad news outweighs the good news. And because I fought for a long time, I'm carrying a lot of baggage into my relationship with God. But this time he's helping me carry them. Matthew 11, 28 to 30. Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy
and my burden is light. My entire life, I was weary and broken from the countless fights I've been in. I never put down my fists because I was scared that if I did, I wouldn't have the strength to put them back up in times of need. Truth is, I found true healing that only comes from giving 100% of myself to God. I don't have to be scared of what life holds for me because I know I no longer have to run. I have rest. I can breathe. Amen. With God, I have true comfort, knowing He'll forever guard me, fighting on my behalf. With God, I am enough. With God, I am healed. Thank you.
Thank you, Naomi. That was very powerful. Hello, everyone. My name is Carmen Awinongia. So the night I was asked to do this testimony, I threw up. I threw up because I was nauseous, and I was nauseous because it was a side effect of a medication I'd taken, a pain reliever I took because I was having a sickle cell pain crisis. As a child, when I had a pain crisis, I wouldn't go to my parents immediately, but I endured the pain in silence, or at least something close to silence. I shared a room with my sister, and to avoid waking her, I would leave the room and lay outside our door. Sometimes I would lay right outside my parents' door, anywhere from 5 to 20 minutes before getting up, going into their room, tapping my mom, and saying, "Ma, I'm in pain." Letting my family help was a last resort because I didn't want to pull my family into my pain. So I would try to wait out the pain as if it would go away or lessen, but it didn't work. I never once successfully managed a pain crisis as a kid. I would always end up in the ER. In hindsight, I would have interrupted my family's nights less if I would have gone to them early in my pain, rather than waiting until the pain warranted an ER visit. But in the moment, all I thought was, "Don't bother anyone. Contain the pain, contain the burden to just you." So I started building up this habit of not letting people help, of not letting people in, and I thought I was strong because of it. It took me preparing for this testimony and speaking with a sister in Christ, thank you, Tesh, to realize I never thought to consider my family would want to wake up to help me in the middle of the night for my pain or take me to the ER because they loved me. I always saw it more as they did it because it was obligatory, because that's just what family had to do. I couldn't see that I was being loved in moments of my physical pain because I disconnected from feeling any emotional pain. I couldn't be crying because I was in physical pain, and I couldn't be crying because I was sad. Honestly, I couldn't be crying at all. Crying wouldn't make the pain go away, and it wouldn't help my family to hear my cries. I couldn't help being physically impacted by those moments of pain, but I could control if I was going to be emotionally impacted by them. And I chose not to be. I could control my emotions more than I could control my disease. And so I ran with it. Unfazed and unbothered became like badges of protection and control for me. I successfully managed a pain crisis last year, and the main reason was because of this church. And uncoincidentally, the first reason I crossed paths with people in this church was because I was hospitalized. And my mom had to come here early, and I didn't know what to do, so we went to Bainbridge Island, and in an ice cream line, I met a group of people who invited me out to church, and I came, and I studied the Bible, and I learned that pride wasn't just arrogance, it was so much more. By not asking for help, wanting to be solely self-reliant, not letting people in, not accepting love, I was being prideful, and calling it protection. I needed to trust God fully, that I wouldn't be permanently hurt if I let people in, if I was vulnerable, if I accepted their help and love. You see, I didn't want to accept help and love from people because I didn't want to expect, depend on, or crave their help and love. I thought that would put me in a weak position. Not getting something you expect is disappointing. Not getting something you depend on is devastating. And not getting something you crave is disheartening. And I wanted to protect myself from all those emotions. And so I became a girl without wants, who became a woman without desires. But now I strive to be a woman of God. Thank you. In Psalms 37, verse 4, it says, "Take delight in the Lord, and he will give you the desires of your heart." Not only can I be a woman with desires, but I am assured that God will give me those desires if I make him Lord and take delight in him. During my sickle cell pain crises, I could easily surrender my body, its condition, its health to God. I didn't question if I was going to be healed or walk out of a hospital. But God doesn't call us just to surrender our bodies to him. Our hearts need to be surrendered as well. God can protect and heal my heart as much as he does my body. I now look to Jesus as inspiration and a perfect example of vulnerability. Jesus let people in. He wept. He had expectations of people, and he wanted them to follow him, be with him, stay up with him when he was in pain, even if he knew the outcome. Are you in pain today? Because God's arms are reaching out to you through the pain, and he's waiting for you to reach back and say, "Father, I'm in pain," to let him in, to let him help you, to let the people he's put in your life help you. Independence is not the answer. And you are not a burden. So please accept the love. Thank you.
Well, good afternoon. Thank you so much, Naomi and Carmen. My name is Jenny, and my first lesson on learning what it means to surrender to God's plan was through the early days of my relationship with my husband, Stephen. We met when we were 15 years old, and our relationship was consumed with selfishness, with insecurity, and bitterness, because we lacked a lot of guidance and direction. Looking back, I believe it was because we constantly looked to each other for comfort and not to God. It wasn't until we started seeking a relationship with God individually that everything started to change. I was tempted to continue clinging to the unhealthy parts of the relationship that I knew were unhealthy, but I also knew deep down that seeking God was the very best thing that we could do. Naturally, I'll believe it when I see it type of person. I find great comfort in being in control of my situations, knowing the outcomes, yet it's funny because throughout my life, God has always called me to trust in him through various scenarios. He called me to trust in him when, at 18, I decided to transform my life completely, become a Christian, and I've never looked back. When, shortly before marrying Stephen, my family deeply opposed us because of our faith in God. And this was truly a very heartbreaking time for me. When, at 8 months pregnant, we gave up our full-time jobs, our comfortable home, and the help from our family, and moved to Boston to help establish a church there. And lastly, a few years after that, we moved back to our hometown in Eugene, and shortly after, God called us to move up here to Seattle. Shortly before moving to Seattle in 2021, our oldest son, Connor, started battling with horrible, recurring pain in his leg. The pain was unexplainable, and it took about 2 years and many, many, many different doctor's appointments to get connected finally with a specialist here at Seattle Children's to finally get some answers. At our first appointment there, The doctor reviewed his lab work and his imaging and became very concerned that Connor had either bone cancer or leukemia due to the severe inflammation throughout his body and his bones. At that point, we were faced with our worst nightmare as parents. It truthfully were some of the darkest moments in my life because I was really forced to surrender my son's health to God, and I knew this was certainly not an outcome that I had any control over. All I could do was cry, and I had such a hard time giving up my son's diagnosis over to God. Honestly, I was angry with God. I questioned him. I asked, why would God do this? Haven't I given him everything and done everything he's asked of me? After lots of further testing and ultimately a surgery, it was determined that fortunately, Connor did not have cancer, but he had a rare inflammatory disease, autoinflammatory disease, that causes chronic and debilitating pain that at times is very difficult to manage. Though dealing with many different medications, shots, side effects, frequent appointments, those all can be very challenging to navigate. But the hardest part for me was really seeing Connor's bright spirit dim. I wanted nothing more for him to be carefree and untouched by hardship. And if any of you deal with chronic pain, you know how all-consuming it can be. I felt helpless and at times hopeless, worried that he would not be able to live a full, active, and life without limits. I decided to pray and fast for all of it to just miraculously go away by his next doctor's appointment, which is a few months later. I thought for sure God would want to be holding on a miracle for us like that. But at that appointment, we had actually learned that the inflammation throughout his body had gotten significantly worse. Despite being very disappointed at those results, I actually felt stronger and more at peace through my decision to focus on prayer, fasting, and scriptures. God really helped my heart to be surrendered. One of the scriptures that I clung to most during this time was Psalm 23, verse 4. And in the Passion Translation, it says, "Lord, even when your path takes me through the valley of the deepest darkness, fear will never conquer me, for you already have. Your authority is my strength and my peace. The comfort of your love takes away my fear. I will never be lonely, for you are near." I would go on walks and cry out to God to give me the strength to be strong for Connor, to remind him of where God was in all of this. I prayed to turn the mess that I felt into a message of hope. I prayed that through all of this, that God would be glorified with healing or without. Looking back over the last several years, it's no doubt that God arranged for our family to be right near an excellent children's hospital, which has an incredible team of doctors who specialize specifically in Connor's condition. If we hadn't been willing to obey God's plan and move here, it would have really hindered our ability to get the proper care that he needed, and I can't help but think how much better off Connor will be because of that. Many people travel from all over the United States to get help from the specialists that we're fortunate to have so close by. Through all of this, God has allowed us to meet an incredible family who shares nearly our exact same journey, as their son was diagnosed with this exact same condition that Connor has. Shockingly, they live minutes from our home and our kids go to the same school. The odds of that are truly one in a million, and my friend Kadeen is with us here today. With this, each experience in my life, God has exposed my fear, my doubt, my insecurity, and my desire to take control. There are moments I questioned God and his power, but what I didn't realize, though, was that each time, God was refining and molding my character. I had to learn to trust that God works in your life through hardship, surrender, and faith. Leaving space for God to work is the most inspiring thing because it takes me out of God's way. When I try to shield my life from God, I end up shielding God from me. But by relinquishing that control, I can sit at his feet and watch God's story unfold. And truthfully, that's the best story that will ever be told. Thank you.
How can you not be inspired by those women? Can you please just like give them another round? It's not easy to get up here and share. Wow. You've all really touched my heart, and I appreciate just the raw, just honest, real talk. Don't you? I mean, people that you relate to, that you connect with. Thank you. Thank you, each one of you, wherever you went. I lost track of you. I keep looking over there. But thank you just for sharing just intimate parts of your lives and your story and your pain, because pain is real. Life is hard. Ladies, like, life can be hard, especially if we're not anchored into God. And so I appreciate it. I thank you for fighting for true healing. Naomi, thank you for fighting. Carmen, thank you for fighting for the freedom to be vulnerable, to get vulnerable. And Jenny, thank you for just getting to complete surrender, even when the scary stuff happens. You know, scary stuff happens. And thank you for anchoring your lives into God and getting your identity there. I know I relate. I relate to each one of your stories in one way or another. And I'm sure that all of you do. Because, wow, we've lived a lot of life in this room. So remember that your story matters. Whatever has gone on in your life, it matters. It's sculpting you into the woman that God wants you to be. So please take a few minutes to thank these brave women during intermission. You know, ask them, how did God help them turn their mess into a message of inspiration and purpose and hope? And take a few minutes to share a little bit about your own story. Because, you know, these are precious moments that we can share and connect more deeply with one another. So don't miss that opportunity. Thank you, ladies. We are going to give our attention to India Lee. So she is going to cover a very fitting song right now called Glowing Up. And I hope that you'll listen carefully to the lyrics. Come on up. Welcome her to the stage. You're going to do a great job.
Staring to see a picture of me, but it's too hard to look in my eyes. I know I'm ashamed I might find what I left behind, what I worked for so long to hide. But in the end, I know what's incredible is a chance to change myself. 'Cause diamonds don't shine till they've been buried alive. Oh, but I've been in the rut for long enough. Tonight I'm glowing up, and diamonds can't sparkle till they find light they can follow. The pressure gets tough for just long enough. Tonight I'm glowing up, glowing up, glowing up. Scared at the sight of the sun's dying light, we recoil at the cold of the night. And though we forget that the moon and the stars will come soon, and we'll bathe in the warmth of their light, I still remember the time when each day was for crying. Oh, I truly hold them dear. They're the storm that got me. I've been in the ruts for long enough. diamonds don't shine, and diamonds can't sparkle. The pressure gets tough for just long enough. Tonight I'm glowing up. Find light they can follow. The pressure gets tough, but just long enough. Tonight I'm glowing, I'm going up. Tonight I'm glowing, I'm going up. Tonight I'm glowing, I'm going up. Glowing up.
Expression of who we are, and just a gorgeous voice. Doesn't she have a gorgeous voice? I know we had a little tech difficulties in there, but you could still hear her really special voice. And I don't know if you caught some of the words. Did you catch the words about that diamonds need the light to really sparkle? So think of yourself as a diamond today, and you need the light to really just bring out your brilliance. So, wow, I feel very filled up already, and we're going to take a very short intermission, 10 minute. I just got that 10-minute, the 10-minute break. So when we come back, and just enjoy just some sweet connection real quick, eat a little bit of your charcuterie box. I think we have some dessert coming your way. And then when we return, there'll be a special performance, and we'll get to hear from our keynote speaker. So, 10 minutes.
I'm not okay with that.
Now we are in for a very, very special treat. We're just about to witness an incredible and dynamic dance performance. Yes. Crafted by our performers, Milena, Keren, Rishelda, and Naomi. And the song that they're dancing to is entitled, it's a song by Emily Sande called Read All About It, Part 3. And the story is simply about four women who struggle with shame, fear, and insecurity. And yet, despite their struggles, they're able to find inspiration from the story of one another, later to finally desire to share their main inspiration with women all over the world to overcome. Please enjoy.
You're biting your tongue. You've spent a lifetime stuck in silence, afraid you'll say something wrong. If no one ever hears it, how are we gonna learn your song? So come on, come on, come on, come on. You've got a heart as loud as lions, so why let your voice be tamed? Maybe we're a little different, there's no need to be ashamed. You've got the light to fight the shadow, so stop hiding.
I wanna see.
dynamic dance performance. Let's give them one more round of applause. That was truly a wonderful display of overcoming. At this time, we have our incredible ushers helping us out here, setting up the stage. Thank you. We finally come to the portion of our event in which we get to hear from our lovely guest speaker, Shauna. You know, Shauna is one of my dear friends in the faith, and one of my favorite memories together with Shauna in Portland was when we spent a lot of time together with the kids. Shauna and I were in the ministry together, and something that I've always admired about her truly was her ability to be present, to be so playful with her children, very giving, so genuine, and at the same time, very level-headed. She has truly inspired me. And today, we get to hear her speak. She is a women's ministry leader in the Portland International Christian Church. She leads alongside her high school sweetheart, her husband, Preston Inkley. They have two amazing children. And just a fun fact, Shauna used to be in the Army, the U.S. Army, for 10 years. And she served as an intelligence analyst. So that tells a lot about her. She's a smart woman, very driven, very ambitious, and knows how to focus, yet knows how to play too. And one last fact about her is that she was baptized in our sister church in Honolulu, Hawaii, just 12 short years ago. And I'm just so excited to hear you share, Shauna. She's got such a powerful message for all of us today. I give you Shauna Inkley.
Good afternoon, ladies. I was a little confused because Nat never asked me for a bio, but I guess it's because Nat knows my whole life. I was going to share all of those things that she shared, but now you already know it about me. But a couple of things I wanted to say was, one, thank you so much, Courtney, for being my friend, for being my leader, my mentor, and just a partner in the gospel here in the Pacific Northwest. It feels so encouraging and honestly such an honor to be able to speak to you ladies today. And also, I just wanted to lift up the testimonial speakers. I love what Renee said at the end. I can identify with all of them, can you? And I was like, yes, I took notes. I can identify with all of them. With Naomi for fighting your whole life, trying to resist healing because healing is hard. That was me. Carmen, not wanting to be vulnerable or let people in and using pride as a protection method. That was me. And Jenny and I go way back all the way to Boston. Fun fact is I was actually the first person that Jenny photographed the proposal, engagement, and the wedding for. I feel very honored by that. All my pictures are beautiful because of Jenny. And Jenny, I could relate to you so much on just really turning your mess of a life into a message. And for you, it was a message of hope. And for me today, I hope I can share that it's a message of inspiration. And so the title of my lesson today is I Am Her Inspired. And just in case you're wondering, because I got asked how old I was today, and I'm actually 32, going on 33 this year. And like Nat said, my husband and I have, I always say we've been dating, but he's my husband, but we've been dating for 15 years. And I'm a proud mama to two beautiful children. Elliot is 5 and Riley is 2. And I don't know if you're like me, but when I first heard the theme, I Am Her Inspired, my thoughts are, who is she? Am I her? And what's so inspiring? Because it's just like you're invited to this event. Come to my event. I Am Her Inspired. It's like, are you her? Am I? Who is her? Who is she? And so I hope by the end of today, you will be confident that you are her, the inspired woman of God. And some quotes about being inspired are from Kobe Bryant, you gotta throw Kobe in here. The most important thing is to try to inspire people so that they can be great in whatever they do. By Thomas Leonard, inspiration is being motivated by a person or an idea. Motivation is being inspired by an object. When people are inspired, they don't need motivation. And by Stacy Hunt, to be inspired is great, but to inspire is an honor. And studying out the word inspired in the scriptures, Courtney found another version, I think it's the Passion Translation, where the word inspired is used in Jeremiah. And I searched high and wide to find the root word for inspired in the scriptures, and I could only find it in 2 Timothy 3:16, which says all scripture is God-breathed, which means inspired, and is useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness. And what I realized was that we don't need a bunch of scriptures that say the word inspired because the Bible says that all scripture is inspiring. And so it doesn't matter whether you were inspired by the testimonial or whether you were inspired by the lesson or if you're inspired by the woman that's sitting right next to you, all of us were brought here today because of God and because of his word, because it's having an effect in the lives of many women. And we want to inspire that word into as many women in the Seattle area. I'm from Portland, but really we're trying to do it internationally. And so in the scriptures, the word inspired means to breathe life into, to make alive, or what we're going to be talking about today, to fill up. And the opposite is lifeless, dead, and empty. And I'm going to be sharing two stories today of two women who were both inspired by Christ. The first one is the Samaritan woman in John chapter 4, and the second one is me. And so the first point I have for you today is inspired to empty. And I know that after hearing the testimonials, many of us were moved, but in the back of some of our heads, you might be thinking, I'm not hopeless or hurting or whatever. I don't need to be vulnerable. I don't need to surrender. I got this. I'm living my best life. And maybe that's what you're thinking, because that's what I was thinking when I first came around Christian women. I was like, I don't need what you have. I'm great. I'm good. And I want to hopefully convince you that all of us need filling from God. So in John chapter 4, in verse 1, it says, now Jesus learned that the Pharisees had heard that he was gaining and baptizing more disciples than John, although in fact it was not Jesus who baptized, but his disciples. So he left Judea and went back once more to Galilee. Now he had to go through Samaria. So he came to a town in Samaria called Sychar, near the plot of ground Jacob had given his son Joseph. Jacob's well was there, and Jesus, tired as he was from the journey, sat down by the well. It was about noon. And here, Jesus takes the straight path from Judea to Galilee through Samaria. And it says that Jesus needed to go through Samaria. But there actually was another route to Galilee that would have been easier because for the Jews, it would have allowed them to avoid all contact with the Samaritans. And Jews and Samaritans did not mesh together. But Jesus didn't take the usual path to avoid Samaria. He took the path to go through Samaria. Why? Because there were people, specifically one woman, who needed to come into contact with Jesus. And maybe you tried to avoid coming today. Maybe you tried to take the long route or tried to get stuck in traffic or tried to have a chaotic morning and everything was just working out smoothly and that's why you're sitting in the seats. Because you needed to be here today. God wanted you to be here today. And this journey was a 70-mile journey, 35-hour walk, 2.5 marathons. And Jesus, even though he was fully God, he was also fully man. And he submitted himself to this journey, to human limitations. So, of course, it says, by the end, he was tired and thirsty. Like, after 2.5 marathons, I am not tired and thirsty. I am dead. But Jesus, it says, he was tired and thirsty. And at the time is noon, the hottest time of the day. In verse 7, it says, when a Samaritan woman came to draw water, Jesus said to her, will you give me a drink? His disciples had gone into town to buy food. The Samaritan woman said to him, you're a Jew. I'm a Samaritan woman. How can you ask me for a drink? For Jews do not associate with Samaritans. So this woman, she came to the well to fill her empty jar with water. But what we'll find out is she would leave without her jar, but she would leave with a full life. And just some background information, the Babylonians, they conquered the southern kingdom of Judah. They took almost all the population captive. They exiled them. And then all they left behind was the lowliest class of society because they didn't want these lowly regarded people to be with them in Babylonia. And the people they left behind intermarried with other non-Jewish people who ended up forming the Samaritans. And so this was an ethnic and religious group, unwanted and disregarded. I don't know if you have ever felt unwanted, disregarded, maybe like an outcast because of your gender, from being a woman, because of your race. We have so many different cultures here. Or maybe because of your past. But that's this woman. She was unwanted and disregarded by almost everybody. And here she is at the hottest point of the day, drawing water at a well. Why? In the scriptures, it says the woman would have drawn water at sunset when it was the coolest time of the day. But this woman went to a very far well away from Samaria to draw water at the hottest time of the day. What do you think? Well, it says all women would be going to the well around sunset. And she alone went to the well around noon. Clearly, she was trying to avoid other women. And I can relate to that. I lived a life of wanting to avoid a lot of women. She was an outcast. She was ashamed. But little did she know, you cannot hide your life from Jesus. Jesus wants a drink, and he asks this woman for one. And this is theologically profound, because Jesus, the preeminent God of all creation, he was with God in the beginning. Everything was made through Jesus and by Jesus. He's the image of God. He's almighty. He's all-powerful. And yet, he reveals himself to this unwanted, a Samaritan woman, by a well, this outcast in her own society. And he says, "Will you please give me a drink?" Who are we that we would be able to give the Creator anything? Who are we that we would be able to help him, aid him, refresh him, bless him? Are you following me? This is theologically profound. And he's saying to this woman, "You can give me a drink." Jesus didn't need this woman. He didn't need her water. He didn't need anything from her. He doesn't need anything from me. And he doesn't need anything from you. But he wants something from you. He wants something from me. He wants our worship, not our water. She came to the well with an empty jar. And once it got filled up, Jesus is asking her to empty it out again for him. This girl's hot. She's tired. She just went to the well at noon to fill her jar up, and Jesus is like, "Can you empty it for me?" She doesn't even know this man. He's a Jew, and she's not even supposed to be talking to him. You know, Jesus knew she was a Samaritan woman. He knew she was an outcast, and yet he still desired a relationship with her. The same is true for us. Jesus knows you, like the real you. The you that the person next to you doesn't know. The you that maybe nobody in this world knows. Jesus knows you, and he wants to converse with you, and he wants to have a relationship with you. This is Jesus. In verse 10, it says, Jesus answered her, "If you knew the gift of God and who it is that asks you for a drink, you would have asked him, and he would have given you living water." "Sir," the woman said, "you've got nothing to draw with, and the well is deep. Where can you find this living water? Are you greater than our father Jacob, who gave us this well and drank from it himself, as it also the sons and his livestock?" Jesus answered, "Everyone who drinks this water will be thirsty again. But whoever drinks the water that I give them will never thirst. thirst. Indeed, the water I give them will become in them a spring of water, welling up to eternal life. The woman said to him, Sir, give me this water so that I won't get thirsty and have to keep coming here to draw water. You know, the magnitude of what happens here is Jesus finds a Samaritan woman, this outcast, pagan, heathen, sinner, in her mind, the worst of the worst, a completely empty, lifeless woman. And he says to her, Woman, give me a drink. When I first read this, I was like, sounds a little chauvinistic to me. Kind of rude. But it's not. It's an exchange. For a drink, Jesus offers a fountain that would never run dry. God's not about taking from you. God's about the exchange. He says, if you give me one cup from this well, I will give you a fountain that will never run dry. He asks from us the finite, and in exchange, he wants to give us the infinite. One cup, I'll give you a fountain that will never run dry. Just give him what you have. Maybe today you're like, I don't even have a cup to give Jesus. I got like a drop, to be honest. And I used half that drop to get myself here. Maybe you got a half a drop. That's okay. Jesus is saying, whatever you have, if it's just a half of a drop of water, that's really all you've got, can you give that to me? And in exchange, I will give you a fountain that will never run dry. You know, this is what I like to call the infinite exchange. Give God you, and in exchange, he'll give you him. And Isaiah 61, verse 3, it says that God will provide for those who grieve in Zion to bestow on them a crown of beauty instead of ashes, the oil of joy instead of mourning, and a garment of praise instead of a spirit of despair. God takes our ashes, our mourning, and our despair, and he turns it into beauty, joy, and praise. He takes our drop and turns it into an everlasting spring. He takes this lifeless woman and he breathes life into her. And you remember what that means? Inspires her. He breathed life into her. He inspired her. He took the empty woman and filled her up. He took the dull woman and he inspired her. He took the drab to fab, whatever you want to call it. That's what Jesus does. You give God your empty, temporary life, and he turns it around to give you an inspiring, everlasting one. But so many of us, I can relate, when we're empty, lifeless, hurting, or in despair, our worship is silenced. I appreciate Jenny's vulnerability. That's exactly what she shared. When she was hurting her worst, she was tempted to be silent in her worship. And praise God, she didn't, and she turned that around. But that is the temptation for all of us when we're hurting, is to silence our worship. We sit there with our arms folded, and we're like, God, until you do something for me, I'm not moving from here. I'm not praising you. Why would I praise you? Look what you're giving me. Look what you've done in my life. You haven't given me anything. I'm suffering. I'm in pain. I'm bitter. I'm this. I don't have that. That's literally, I can relate to that. We all do that. We're so focused on our bad circumstances. But God says, if you would just worship me from that lifeless, empty circumstance, from that despair, I'll return to you what is infinite, a fountain that never runs dry. You can drink deeply from this salvation. It's not even right if you think about it. It's not fair. God wants to give us what we don't deserve. He wants to give you what you don't deserve. So if you're sitting here thinking like, yeah, I know me, the real me, what's really in my life, and God wouldn't want that. The Bible says that's not true. The Bible says God wants that. God wants you to worship him where you're at now, in your despair, in your hurt, in your pain, in your bitterness, in your pride, whatever's going on in your life, that is what God wants you to worship from. He doesn't want you to wait till you're better to worship him. He doesn't want you to fix your life first, then come to him. He wants you now, today, from where you're at right now. He wants you to give you him. Give everything to him, even when it feels like you've got nothing. He wants you, just like the Samaritan woman, to empty out your jar so he can inspire you, breathe life into you, and fill you up. He's not asking for anything you don't have. And so if we give God what we do have, even if it's just a half a drop, he will do something supernatural with it, the infinite exchange. You know, Jesus, he made this woman curious about some things. He goes, if you only knew the gift of God. And what he made her curious about were the things of God. Are you curious about the things of God? The gift? What is this gift? He made her curious about who Jesus was. He says, who is it? If you knew who it was that says this to you. He's like, girl, you don't even know who I am. If you only knew who I am. Jesus wants us to be curious about him. Who is he? The Messiah? The Savior? The Son of God? God in the flesh? That's Jesus? He wanted her to be curious about what he could give her. He said, if you only knew who I was and you asked me, I would give you living water. And then she's like, what is this living water? I don't ever want to be thirsty again. She thinks it's something that's temporary and like, or that's something that's like material. And he's trying to teach her it's spiritual. So my question for you is, what's stopping up your well? We have nothing that's stopping up our well that Jesus can't handle. You know, Jesus talks about this living water. And, you know, like I said, she came all this way, about a half a mile west of her village, to get this physical water because she was focused on physical things. But Jesus is trying to switch it up for her. It's not about the physical, it's about the spiritual. You know, living water is spiritual water that quenches spiritual thirst and gives life. In the book of Jeremiah, God refers to himself as the fountain of living water. It's only God that can quench a spiritual thirst. And just like we need to depend on water physically, Jesus helps us to see the need of depending on God and to thirst for him spiritually. He made this amazing offer to her. He says, anyone who drinks this water, meaning anyone that comes to God, I will give you lasting satisfaction. And we try to satisfy our inner desire, our inner thirst for God through many other things or through anything except for Jesus. People are thirsty. You know, we long, we search, we reach, but only a relationship with God can satisfy the deepest levels of our soul and spirit. Only God can fill our jar up. In verse 16 and 19, it says, he told her, go, call your husband, and then come back. I have no husband, she replied. Jesus said to her, you are right when you say you have no husband. The fact is, you have five husbands, and the man you now have is not your husband. And she responds with, what you have said is quite true. I can see you're a prophet. She was shocked. You know, a part of coming to Jesus and receiving this living water is we have to allow him to confront our lives, our sin, our past, our emptiness. I loved how vulnerable these women were in their testimonials. We have to decide what we love more, our sin or our Savior. We have to decide what we want more, an empty life or an inspiring one. Jesus goes deep. He's like, go call your husband. She's like, I don't have one. But she's right, I don't have one. She has five and then one on the side. He doesn't candy coat or beat around the bush. He calls out her adultery, her immorality, her impurity, her deceit. He reveals her emptiness. And then she's like, Jesus knows all my secrets. He must be a prophet. You know, and maybe you're here this morning thinking, I can totally relate to this woman. Or maybe you're like, I can't relate to her at all. That does not describe my life. But it's not about what made her empty. It's the fact that she was empty. So it doesn't matter if you can relate to having five husbands and one on the side, or if you can't. you can't, okay? But something is making you empty, and you can relate to that. What is it for you? You got to admit where you are so you can get to where you need to be. Well, it's not really like that, Jesus. This guy is not really my... She didn't do any of that. She was like, I can see you're a prophet. You know my life. And I love that Jesus didn't share everything about her to condemn her or to judge her, but to help her. You know, we can treat people like we're better than them, but we're not better than anybody. And Jesus, even though he was sinless, he didn't treat this woman like he was better than her. He wanted to fill her up. He wanted to inspire her. And we have to stop focusing on the deficiencies and the weaknesses in our lives, and we gotta start focusing on Jesus. Because when you come into the presence of God, change happens. Your situation might not change, but your heart will change. You know, in verse 23 to 26, Jesus teaches her that God is looking for true worshipers, people who will worship God in spirit and in truth. And the same God that was talking to this woman at this well is asking you today, will you give me a drink? Will you give me water? Will you pour yourself out to me? Will you worship me? I don't need anything from you, but I desire you. I want you. God desires your affection. He desires your love. He desires your attention. One person, one lonely, empty woman, is refreshing to God Almighty himself. You know, God's not egotistical. He's not a taker. He's a giver. The miracle isn't that God invites us to worship. The miracle is that he accepts our worship because we're sinners. God's seeking true worshipers, women who will worship God in spirit with excitedness and eagerness, and women who will worship him in truth. That means according to the scriptures, not according to what you think is right, but what God says is right. And women who will be truthful about where they're really at. Jesus displayed so much love and a sense of security that this woman felt safe with him. I don't think she's probably ever felt safe with a man, hence why she has six of them. But she felt safe with Jesus, even when her sin was exposed. You know, this whole interaction didn't leave her feeling like he hates me, he's judging me, he doesn't want me around. It left her with a faith that Jesus was who he claimed to be, the Messiah, God in the flesh. And she was inspired by his words, and that through him and only through him could she truly be filled up. You know, if you keep reading the story, it says that this woman went back to her town and said, come meet the man who told me everything I ever did. This woman was known in this town. She was known. She'd been with a lot of people over there. And imagine her coming back and just being excited that her sin was exposed. Come meet the man who knows all my sin. Come on. You gotta meet him. Really? Yeah, he knows about you and you and you. And he also knows about you too. He knows about us. And she's excited about this. It's kind of weird. It really is if you think about it. But you know what? The woman was inspired. And Jesus knew the facts of her life, and he still loved her. And sometimes we fear if someone really knew me, all that I ever did, they would never love me. But Jesus loved her, and he loves you because he knows you. Jesus is the Savior, and he came to save us, to fill us up, to breathe life into us, and to inspire us. And she left her, it says she left her jar and went to go tell everybody about Jesus. Why would she leave her jar? Because she was already filled up. Jesus filled her up. She didn't need to bring her jar because her thirst was quenched, and Jesus's was too. Because inspired people inspire people. And inspired women inspire women. And I don't have much time, but I just want to share a little bit about myself. So I grew up with an incredible life. My parents were awesome, loving, together. Everything was great. I loved my life. My parents raised us hardworking and fight for what you got, and it was great. But when I was 16, my parents got divorced, and my best friend died in a tragic accident. And for the first time in my life, I felt insecurity. I felt unsure, I felt unloved, and I didn't know how to voice my feelings, but I knew I needed to get filled up a little bit because I was feeling empty. And so I chose to take my pain and rebel. And to no longer be a good girl, I wanted to explore the world and dabble in some darkness. And that I did. And through the dabbling in darkness, I became empty. And most of my emptiness can be summed up into one scripture, which is Galatians 5, verse 19 to 21. And I want to read it in the Passion Translation. It says, "The behavior of the self-life is obvious. Sexual immorality, lustful thoughts, pornography, chasing after things instead of God, manipulating others, hatred of those who get in your way, senseless arguments, resentment when others are favored, temper tantrums, angry quarrels, only thinking of yourself, being in love with your own opinions, being envious of the blessings of others, murder, uncontrolled addictions, wild parties, and all other similar behavior." This became my life. And I believed the deception that it was impossible to be loved unless you had sex outside of marriage. Sexual impurity was normal, and you were weird if you didn't do it. That talking about feelings made you weak, so I acted like everything was always okay, and I tried to be strong. That reconciliation showed that you were weak, and confrontation showed that you were strong. So I argued about everything, and I always defended myself. My opinions were always right, and they were always better than everybody else's. That's not the truth, it's just what I believed. I believed getting drunk multiple nights a week was fine and not unhealthy. I believed going to parties was cool, but throwing them four times a week was even cooler. I believed lying was okay as long as I didn't get caught. I believed that being a female soldier and serving for 10 years validated me and that would give me the life that I dreamt of. I was on the hunt for love and security, but I didn't even realize it. But in Galatians 5, there's this other list, and it's the fruits of the Spirit. And it says, "The fruits produced by the Holy Spirit within you is divine love in all its varied expressions. Joy that overflows, peace that subdues, patience that endures, kindness in action, a life full of virtue, faith that prevails, gentleness of heart, and strength of spirit." And these two lists are mutually exclusive. You can either have one or the other. You can't have both. And so when 12 years ago when I studied the Bible and I was read this first list, I was like, Jesus knows everything I've ever done. How does he know that? I literally said that. How did he know everything I've ever done? And they're like, girl, this was written like thousands of years ago. It's in the Bible. I'm like, but it's everything I've ever done. And they're like, I know. Jesus knows everything you've ever done. And I was excited about it, like the Samaritan woman. I was like, he knows everything I've ever done and he still wants me? And they were like, yeah. So I realized that I couldn't have this second list without getting rid of the first. And I realized that Jesus wanted to inspire me. Through his word, he wanted to change me for me to empty my cup so he could fill mine up everlastingly. And so who was this perfect man that came into contact with me 12 years ago? Jesus, the same man who knew everything that I ever did but wanted to fill my cup up. The same man who, instead of taking my dignity away by exposing my sin, wanted to give me his dignity. I was inspired. I came to Jesus with a heavy jar, but it was empty. And he filled me up. I came to him so thirsty, but my thirst was quenched with Jesus. And, you know, I don't know where you're at today, but I'm sure that there's some type of emptiness in your life. I'm sure that there's some type of thirst that needs to be quenched. And through the process of studying the Bible with incredible women that God divinely brought into my life, maybe like today, I developed and I grew my faith. I made the tough but very easy decision to empty my jar and to pour it out completely for Jesus. And I was made into a disciple of Jesus, repented of my sin. I was baptized on February 9th, 2012 in Honolulu, Hawaii. And I was completely inspired to have a relationship with God. And over the past 12 years, it's not been all sunshine and rainbows. I'm not a sinless woman. I am sinful. I'm not a walking inspiration board. I make so many mistakes. But I am inspired. I'm inspired to never allow my jar to be empty because of God's word fills it up. I'm inspired to stay open about my life and my struggles and allow godly women in my life to help me. I'm inspired to live for God, not for myself. I'm inspired to inspire others. God was inspired and he created the world, but he didn't do it for himself. He did it for us. Inspired people inspire people. And my prayer today is you walk out of this building with purpose. If you came in here struggling to breathe, I pray you have the breath of life in you. If you came here empty, I pray you can now walk out eager to be filled. If you came here already inspired, then I pray you walk out ready to inspire someone else. Inspired women inspire women. All of us have been her before, and all of us can be inspired by Jesus. Anyone can change. The Samaritan woman did, I did, and you can. So let's be like the Samaritan woman. Share the emptiness in your life, the sin you've committed, and come to Jesus and let him fill you up. Let him inspire you. He's the living water, and only through his perfect plan can you be filled with life. I encourage you to study the Bible with the woman who invited you out and to be willing to allow the scriptures to inspire you. I love you so much. I am her, inspired.
Absolutely loved hearing about the Samaritan woman. I've heard about the Samaritan woman for many, many years. Shauna, thanks for just giving us a new look at her. And just a new description. You know, it made me really think about when I first had my first encounter with Jesus and what it was that I needed to empty out. And that was a long time ago, 44 years, to be honest, that I had my first encounter with Jesus. And I remember back then what was really stopping me up was bitterness and anger and unforgiveness. I didn't like how I'd been raised. And I just had a lot in my heart. And I definitely felt empty at that time. This was a long time ago. And I'm so grateful that I made that decision to really let God fill me up. My life has been extraordinary and so fulfilling for the most part. But I will tell you, over that 44 years, there's been a lot of time that I've had to go back and really evaluate what was stopping me up. What was keeping me, holding me back? You know, whether it was that I needed healing, like Naomi talked about today, or I needed to get that exposure, to get more vulnerable, to go to the places that were hard and let people really know me differently, you know, or to resurrender. You know, I've had a lot of moments on my journey where I needed to resurrender. So grateful that I did. So wherever you're at today, if you're just coming to Jesus for the first time and you're really thinking, wow, this is different. Like I need to take a deeper look at my life. Or maybe you've been on a journey for a while. Don't miss the opportunity to really let your light shine. And you know, I want to ask you, what is it? And write this down. What is it that you need to empty out so that Jesus can fill you up? So I want to ask you, moving on, thank you so much. Give Shauna another round of applause. She did such a fabulous job. I know you really spoke to our hearts today. Thank you for letting God use you. So I'm going to ask Alexis to come on up. She is going to be introducing two women who've excitingly decided to be baptized today.
Well, it has been an incredible afternoon. I am so inspired, but there's nothing more inspiring than see two young women come before the Lord and just be right with him. And I appreciate that the word of God revives us and it really calls us to such a decision. And so I want to bring up the first woman, Cece. Come on, Cece. And I will hand it over to Dee Dee to share a little more.
Come on, Dee Dee. Hi, everyone. This is Cece. She's a junior at the University of Washington. She studies computer engineering, but she was actually met two Sundays ago. She studied last Friday, and she's ready to make Jesus Lord. All right, Cece, I have the two most important questions of your life. Do you believe that Jesus was the Son of God? He lived a sinless life on earth. He died on the cross for your sins and was resurrected on the third day.
Yes, I do. What is your good confession?
That Jesus is Lord.
Because of your good confession, we can now baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. You will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit, and your sins will be forgiven, and you will be added to God's holy kingdom. Yeah. And I'll just let Cece share very briefly.
I just wanted to say thank you to God, first of all, for bringing these people into my life. Didi was actually the third person to come up to me since I moved to Seattle, and Esther was the second and figured out their roommates when I walked in, and we knew each other already. So I also grew up Christian. My dad was a pastor, but I just want to say that it's very different when you're old enough to actually know what's happening and to choose this yourself. So I just want to say thank you to God for allowing me to choose this and come to Him in His time.
Awesome. Well, I bring you guys Kira. Some of you have already met her, but Kira is from South Africa. She's actually here as an au pair, and her host mom is here taking a video. So cute. But she's been here since last year, and God has truly been working in her life in many ways. We've been studying the Bible for 3 weeks, and I've really had the privilege to witness her transformation firsthand. Kira, you've truly become a sister to me. You've become a close friend of mine. I'm so, so proud of you. When I think of you, I think of Matthew 21:44. It says, anyone who falls on this stone will be broken to pieces. Anyone on whom it falls will be crushed. And you have fallen on the stone. At our last study, you were like, what else can I give up? I'm giving it all up. And it's so true. I've enjoyed every moment of studying the Bible with you. I love that we call it Bible study shandies, which is like a South African thing. But I really, really am proud of you. I'm excited to call you my sister soon and very soon. It's a beautiful thing that you are making Jesus Lord of your life. And I'm really glad that I got to be part of your journey. So with that, I'll give you an opportunity to share.
Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for the opportunity for me to share with you today. I stand here with a heart full of gratitude and anticipation. I'd like to share scripture. It's Luke 9, verse 24. For whoever wants to save their life will lose it. Whoever loses their life for me will save it. I never really knew how hard it was being a disciple of the Lord. It means surrendering. It means dying to yourself every single day. At first, I was scared and I was nervous. Control was everything to me. Control is comfort for six-year-old little Kira who barely knows what's happening around her. Control is comfort for 15-year-old depressed Kira. She was dusty. Now I can say that all that control was not fulfilling, and it's a cup that never sees more than a quarter of water. But imagine that control up, imagine giving that control up to God and just floating while He directs the current. And while He's doing that, there's a breeze that caresses your face. Not only is it an honor to give my control up, but I'm made comfortable while I'm there. Now I feel at peace. I've never felt so complete and so fulfilled. And Luke 23, verse 43, Jesus answered, truly, I tell you, today you will be with me in paradise. And I cannot imagine a more beautiful picture. I'd like to, first of all, thank God. Second of all, thank Kenan. Kenan was the first person that I met along this journey randomly. And from Kenan passed me over to Rachelda. She was the first woman that I spoke to, which brought me to Haley, Ingrid, Erin, Manuela, everybody, Caitlin, if you're there, hi. Phenomenal woman that's really blessed me on this journey. It's so amazing to say that I have a sisterhood, and I'm so excited. And thank you to everyone that has pulled out in times of my surrendering. I remember I couldn't get a hold of any of these girls, and Rachelda had just followed me on Instagram. It's like 10:09 p.m. and I'm like, Rachelda, I'm a mess, I can't do anything, I don't know what's going on. And she spoke to me so purely, so kindly, and Manuela, everybody that's just really opened their heart out to me, I just wanted to say thank you.
Come on, Kira.
All right, Kira. I have the two most important questions of your life. Do you believe that Jesus was the Son of God, that he was sinless, he lived a sinless life on earth, died on the cross for your sins, and was resurrected on the third day?
Yes.
And what is your what is your good confession?
That Jesus is Lord.
Because of your good confession, we can now baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. You will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. All your sins will be forgiven, and you'll be added to God's kingdom.
Yes.
And these are for you.
Awesome.
The baptisms will take place right after service outside.
What a tremendous time we've had today. I really hope you guys are feeling inspired, encouraged, refreshed, and reinvigorated. Right now, we are headed to our close. Can you believe we finally come to this point? I definitely know that I myself have been fed. I hope you have all been fed as well, not just in your hearts, but also in your minds and in your spirits. I do want to say a very special, first and foremost, thank you to Shauna. Yes, we have something for you. Thank you so much for your incredible message and your hard work that you put into our lesson today. Enjoy, enjoy. In her basket, there are lots of Seattle key tokens to help her just get that experience of Seattle all within a basket. I also want to say thank you to all the behind-the-scenes crews, the AV team, our valiant ushers for serving us in and out of the rows constantly. Thank you to our already mentioned sponsors, and thank you to the performers, our speakers, and last but not least, thank you so much to our lead director and head coordinator, Courtney Parlor and Alexis Holder. Wow, this event could not have been an opportunity if it weren't for your leadership. You guys are incredible examples of hardworking women, so inspiring, the definition of inspired, right here. And in closing, I do have three quick announcements to make. The first one is, if you haven't noticed, we have a quick little short stand out there in front in the hallway, the lobby area. And we want you guys to take a look at the merch. Today was a fantastic time, and there's been a lot of thought and creativity put into the merch itself. We have black crew neck long sleeve shirts for you to enjoy, and the logo is printed right on the front that says inspired, and the scripture right there. So just a little something to take home with you today. Please check that out. But also, secondly, tomorrow is Sunday. If you are available, we would love to invite you out to our Sunday church service at the University of Washington in the Architecture Hall, room 147. If you need any details, please feel free to ask the woman who has invited you out. We would love for you to be there. And of course, that right after this, we will have the baptism. So if you're free to stick around for a little bit, please join us out there on the front lawn. It should be really quick, but we're ready to celebrate. So thank you all for joining us today. We will miss you, but we'll see you very, very soon.
To hide, but in the end, I know what's incredible.